Ascent TV is proud to present Faith Collective, presented by Sheikh Hanif Mohammed.
Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to another installment of the Faith Collective. I'm Hanif Mohammed and I'm your host. This is the show where we help our Muslim brothers and sisters with their dawah issues. On the last episode, we discussed the condition of the people of pre-Islamic Arabia. And we also talked about the Prophet's great immaculate character, how he used great etiquettes and mannerisms to explain and spread the religion of Islam. This week, we will continue to do so. Good moral character cannot be measured, and the importance of it is actually immeasurable. What we're going to do today is we're going to talk about a few people that decided to leave their good moral conduct and what it cost them. We could talk about Alex Rodriguez and other baseball players that are caught up right now in a steroid scandal. They decided to use these illegal drugs so that they can enhance their play on the baseball field. They did achieve their goal by elevating their game, but because they use bad moral conduct, they may never enter into the Baseball Players Hall of Fame. We could look at Michael Phelps. He's the greatest Olympian ever. He's won more gold medals than any other person that participated in the Olympics. But because of bad decisions he made, because his morality was not in check, he lost a lot of sponsors. He lost a lot of money. We could look at the former governor of New York, Eliot Spitzer. He had to resign from his office because he would go out and do bad, immoral things. Recently, the governor of Illinois lost his place. He was impeached as the governor because he had a bad, immoral character. So we could never, ever place an importance, how important it is to have good moral character. Because of people's bad moral characters, they lost jobs, positions, and status. I beg you not to allow your character to be the cause of someone not accepting Islam. In Islam, the study of ethics or good moral character is called akhlaq. That study, that science, is very vast, and we'll need a lot of class time and a lot of hours to really understand how this science works. But for our purposes, what we'll do today is we'll give a very general definition of what akhlaq is. Akhlaq is an Arabic term referring to the practice of virtue, morality, and manners in Islamic theology and philosophy. It is most commonly translated in English dictionaries as disposition, nature, temper, ethics, morals, or character of a person. Our Imams and our Prophet have said that man can cultivate himself by having that inner struggle against himself. Remember, that's the greater jihad. If he struggles hard against himself, he can remove his immoral tendencies. Our Holy Prophet has said about this important subject, our religion is based on cleanliness. According to Ayatollah Puya, this does not refer to outward cleanliness alone. It also alludes to the soul's inner purity. To attain perfection, it is necessary to struggle against lust and immoral tendencies and prepare the soul to receive God's grace. If man travels the path of purification, God will aid him and guide him. As the Quran says, and as for those who struggle in our cause, surely we guide them in our ways. While preparing for this episode, I had the opportunity to read the book by Allama Muhammad Baqir Majlisi, Hayatul Qulub, Volume 2, pages 90 through 91, about the perfect, immaculate, good moral character of our Holy Prophet, the Prophet Muhammad. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. What we're going to do from this point on is to go back and see exactly what it was that Allama Majlisi said about our Prophet and see how it is that we could incorporate this into our form of dawah so that we could give the proper dawah and bring the people into Islam the same way that our Holy Prophet did. The first quote that I'll use from Allama Majlisi is, the Prophet was always the first to give salutations on meeting any person. This is very important when we're going to give dawah, and it's a very good act of etiquette in general. You know, there are a lot of people who think that because we're Muslims or because of a position that we have, that people should come to us, that they should be the first people to greet us. But who's higher than our Prophet Muhammad? And what he would do is he would go out and extend his hand first in greeting people. He was always the first. As a side note, this reminds me of a lesson that I learned in Islamic seminary or Hausa. Every action that we do in life will fall into one of five categories. We have these five categories, and the first of them is wajib. If an act is considered wajib, it's an act that has to be done. It's a command to do it. And if we do the command, we get a reward for doing it. If we don't do the command, there's a punishment for it. The next type of act that we have is mustahab. And a mustahab act is an act that is highly, highly recommended. If we do this mustahab act, we're rewarded for it. But if we don't do the act, there's no reward for it. The next act is mubah, which means that it's permissible. It's not good for you, it's not bad for you. It's right in the gray. There's no reward, there's no punishment. Then you have the makruh. This is an undesirable act. It's frowned upon. If you do this act, it's only frowned upon. You aren't punished for it. But if you abstain from the act, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you as if you did a good act. The last of the categories would be haram, or acts that are forbidden, or acts that are sins. If you commit this act, you will be punished for it. But if you abstain from it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you a reward for it, as if you had did a good act. Now sometimes, every once in a while, a mustahab act, remember that's an act that is highly recommended, carries a greater reward for it than an act that is wajib, an act that you have to perform. One of the acts that falls into this category would be actually greeting the person first. As we said, the Prophet would always go and greet people first. This act, this mustahab act of greeting first, is mustahab because you don't have to greet anybody first. But because of the Quranic verse, we have to return the greeting once it's given to us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran concerning this verse, and when you are greeted with a greeting, greet it with a better greeting than that, or return it. Surely Allah takes account of all things. According to Ayatollah Puya, Muslims get a great benefit from that. He says of this verse, the customary greeting in Islam is Assalamu alaikum, peace be on you. While that greeting is returned, Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and on you be peace and blessings of Allah. These gentle and cordial words of greeting each other have created a unique sense of brotherhood amongst the Muslim master and servant, rich and the poor, learned and the unlettered. They both greet each other with dignity. And there is no loss when they greet one another. Everybody feels that they're equal. Now we have our first tool as far as giving dawah is concerned. That is, we need to be the first to greet anyone that we're going to give dawah to. Our holy prophet, this was one of his sunnahs. This was one of his traditions. So now it must become one of our traditions. This is a way to bring warm feelings between you and another person. So greeting the people first is our first tool for giving dawah. Alama Majlisi had also said, when the prophet addressed a person, he did not look out at him from the corner of his eye like a rich and haughty man, but he turned his whole body towards the individual with whom he was conversing. Here's another tool. We have to give people our undivided attention. One of the best ways to let someone know that what they're saying is important to you is for a man or a woman or whoever it is that you're talking to, for you to look them directly in the eyes. This lets them know that you care, that you hear everything that they're saying. This was a practice of our holy prophet, and this should also be one of our practices. This again breaks the ice and brings warm feelings towards you and the person that you're trying to share this wonderful deen of Islam with. Alama Majlisi has also said, the prophet never spoke unnecessarily, and when he would open his mouth, he spoke clearly, distinct. His delivery was to the point, full of meaning, illustrating his subject without redundancy, yet perfectly clear and comprehensible. Here's another tool. We have to learn how to communicate verbally with people. That means that when we speak to people, we know exactly what it is that we're talking about. That we don't go off and repeat ourselves all the time when we're speaking to these people about Islam. Our holy prophet Muhammad, it says here, that he didn't talk a lot, but when he did speak, he spoke clearly, he spoke distinctly, and whatever he had to say was very important. Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam has said concerning this, silence is wisdom, abstain from speaking is safety, and concealment is a part of happiness. We know that he learned this from our holy prophet. And because he learned this from our holy prophet, there are many lessons that we could take from this. Sometimes silence is the best thing, so that we can hear out whatever that next person is trying to say. Alama Majlisi has also said, the prophet's temper was gentle, as roughness and severity were not traits of his disposition. He thought no one was hopeless or vile. Here's another tool that we must take into account. Our holy prophet was very gentle. Some people, when they go out to invite people to Islam, they come off like brutes. I mean, they're very disrespectful. They talk very rough. They always complain about others' belief systems, but our prophet didn't do that. Some people will refuse to speak to rich people because they say, you know what? They have money. They have status. They'll never accept Islam. Or they won't speak to the poor people because they'll say, you know, these people, they're not even worth it to come into Islam. Our holy prophet spoke to everybody, the rich, the poor. It didn't matter what your ethnicity or your race or your cultural background was. He said everyone deserved to hear this message of salvation. So it is our job to make sure that everybody has the same opportunity to hear this message. Alama Majlisi had also said, the prophet often smiled, but rarely laughed aloud. Here's another tool that we must use. We have to smile. Nothing opens up the windows to the heart, the windows to the soul, like a warm smile. And I'm trying to show you a nice smile now. But when a person sees you smile, they understand that you're genuine, that you're there to give them good news. If you walk around frowning all the time, why would anybody want to be with you? So, another tool is for us to smile and be very cheery when we give this message of Islam, because this is a happy message. This is a message letting people know that God loves you, and this is the way that we get ourselves closer to God. Alama Majlisi had also said, the prophet bore patiently and the contrary manners of foreigners and Arabs, the former of whom were brought to his assemblies that they might be profited. Here's another tool. We have to bear people's differences with patience. Remember, a lot of us here in this country may come from another country, so you may feel like you don't speak very good English. It's okay. Americans are very, very tender-hearted when they hear somebody trying to speak the language. So if you don't speak very good English, don't worry about it. Just give them the message of Islam and let them know that they could come to the center. And this is a very good opportunity for you to invite people to the center so that they can see Islam for what it really is. And again, our prophet was patient. So patience means that you sit back, you listen, you hear them. You overlook whatever difficulties they may have. You overlook their flaws because your job here is to show that you're patient. And that with patience brings forth understanding. And if you understand what they're trying to say, then you could go back to them and give them this message of Islam, and they will have no problems with listening to what it is that you have to say. Allama Majlisi has also said, "The Prophet never interrupted a speaker, though he perceived some mistakes in what he was saying." Here's another tool. When given dawah, if we can't follow this simple instruction of not interrupting the speaker while they're speaking, then there's no need for us to do dawah at all. People perceive people that cut them off in the middle of a conversation as being rude or being arrogant. Even if the person is saying something wrong, as Allama Majlisi has said, the Holy Prophet never interrupted that speaker. He allowed the speaker to finish what they were saying, and then he went in to do his corrections then. This is a tool that we must use so that we won't lose people because of our rudeness. Allama Majlisi has also said, "The Prophet did good and abstained from evil with the view that people should follow his example, making efforts in such a way as to operate as a motive on them, and endeavoring to do that which would be beneficial to mankind both in this world and in the next." Here's a very, 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 very useful and important tool. You have to always be mindful that people are always watching you. Our Prophet was infallible. That means he made no mistakes, nor did he sin. We're not infallible, but we're struggling every day with the greater jihad to remove any inconsistencies or any bad habits we may have. We hadn't reached the stage of perfection yet. But what we can do is to ensure that people look at us and they always see our good moral conduct is for us to always be mindful that somebody is watching. And if we're out in the public, we are the ambassadors for Islam. And as stated early in one of the early episodes, a lot of times we're the reasons why Islam gets such a bad rap. So what we have to do is we have to do like the Prophet did, and that is all of our actions should be actions that people could come and they can take from us. They must be the best of all actions because we follow the best of all examples. Allama Majlisi has given us 8 tools of conduct from our Holy Prophet Muhammad. And by reading and becoming and beginning to understand these rules of conduct, what we've done is we've truly come to the understanding of how our Prophet has come to perfect our morals. These 8 tools that were given, if used properly, would give us our best chance at giving effective dawah. Those 8 tools, just as a review, are 1, to greet others first when giving dawah. 2, to give our undivided attention to those we are speaking to. 3, to know how to address people verbally when giving dawah. 4, to have the correct temperament when giving dawah. 5, to smile when giving dawah. 6, bear difference with patience when giving dawah. 7, never interrupt the speaker while giving dawah. And 8, is to be mindful that people are always watching you. If we implement these simple tools, we will and we can give effective dawah. We are all human beings and require the necessities of life to survive. We need food for nourishment, water to keep us hydrated and to maintain our cells. We need oxygen for our bodies, and we need shelter to protect us from the elements. We all have responsibilities of paying our rent or our mortgages and the bills that accompany them. We all deal with the elements, heat, cold, storms, and earthquakes. We all have common things that we deal with in our lives, but the way we live our lives are totally different. In a nutshell, we live in a pluralistic society. Some of us are meat eaters, some of us are vegetarians. Some of us like cold weather, and others of us can't imagine living in any place that's not warm. If we think that this is difficult, we have different belief systems. So one of the main problems that a Muslim has that's in the da'wah field is, how do we give the message of Islam to such a diverse amount of people? The answer is very simple. The Islam does not change. The approach that we take as far as giving it to the people, it may change. As stated before, one of the most important things in giving da'wah is to make sure that we don't interrupt the speaker while he's speaking. This is going to be very important because he can be telling you something that you need to know, that you need to hear, so that you are able to understand what he's talking about and know what your approach is as far as giving him da'wah is concerned. A good example of that would be if you were speaking to a person that's a Christian. And this Christian may be a Trinitarian, he may be a Unitarian, he may be a Binitarian. And we'll discuss those things later. But they have three different beliefs in God. But most Christians say, hey, I'm a Christian. But if a person comes to you and you're giving them da'wah, and he says, oh, I'm a Christian, and you cut them off right then and there, what's going to happen if this person says, you know, I'm a Christian, but I have a problem with the Trinity. And because I have a problem with the Trinity, I really don't believe in Christianity like that. I'm just a good person, and I think that if you're a good person, God is going to forgive you and you're going to go to heaven. Now, once you come in and you hear this and you cut him off at, I'm a Christian, and you begin explaining to him why he shouldn't believe in the Trinity, you would have wasted 10 minutes of valuable time that you could have been giving them good da'wah to say, okay, you know what? As a Muslim, we don't believe in the Trinity either. But what he really needs to hear about is, why is it important for them to have a good religious background or a good religious belief system? And that belief system comes from Islam. But if we cut them off and we were rude, he would never get any of that. So again, it's very important that we show the akhlaq of our Prophet, which is his good moral behavior. This is important because once we know what we're dealing with, now we're able to know how it is we need to approach them. One of the most important things for us to do is to have good information, because with good information, we can really, really hit the nail on the head when we're giving specific people da'wah. Our Prophet was patient. We have to be patient. Our Prophet wasn't overbearing. We can't be overbearing. Our Prophet was knowledgeable. We have to become knowledgeable. If we do these things and take our time and be kind, the people will come to Islam. As long as we have good akhlaq and we have good information, the people will come. As a final note, we have to understand that the purpose of da'wah is not to convert anyone. We really don't have the power to convert anyone. If that was the case, then every prophet that came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have converted everybody that they were dealing with. Our purpose is to give good information and to explain Islam to them in such a way that they'll no longer have the negative thoughts that they had about it. And remember, just because a person doesn't accept Islam today doesn't necessarily mean that they won't accept Islam later on. But if we explain Islam properly, what's going to happen is we will have an advocate for our side. Because if they hear someone saying, you know what, Islam is a bunch of crazy people and they don't believe in God, and you know, these crazy things that people think about Islam, if we explain it to them properly, they'll be the first ones to step up and say, hey, you know what? No, I know Muslims. They told me what it is that they believe. And that, what you're talking about, is not what they believe. If we have that, then when the news companies come out, when the newspaper run their articles, they can't put all this foolishness out there anymore, because we have people who have the correct knowledge of what Islam is all about. And as usual, I'll end the show by giving you a quote from Imam Ja'far Sadiq. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. Remember that it's okay to say, I don't know. Because Imam Ja'far Sadiq said, half a knowledge is to say that I don't know. This is a show of humility and knowledge. And in dawah, this is the main purpose, to give good knowledge and to let people know what Islam is all about. Don't worry about it. If you don't know the answer, you could go home, you could research it, and get back to them. That'll be better than you giving them bad information. Now again, this is the people's show. What we want for you to do is send in the email that you see on, send in to us from the email address that you see on your screen, any questions, any comments, any dawah confrontations you've had, or dawah dialogues that you've had. Give us your success stories about dawah so we can share it with everyone else. And give us the processes that you use as far as giving dawah to bring people closer to Islam. Inshallah, in here, and I'll close with Surah Asr, the way that our the companions of the Prophet did when they left one another. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Wal Asr. Inna al-insana lafi khusr. Illa ladina aminu wa amilu salihati. Wa tawassu bil haqi. Wa tawassu bil sabr. Shukran jazila. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Copy, duplication, distribution, and broadcast of this program is strictly prohibited by law without the express written consent of Ascent TV. All rights are reserved to Ascent TV. For more programs like this, visit us online at www.ascenttv.net. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته